Good morning. I'm, as Eric said, the Lois Smith. I'm the interim dean of the College of Business and Economics, and I'm very happy to be here and to indicate to you that the College of Business and Economics is supporting Earth Day activities. Just a little personal revelation. Last night, my husband and I were sitting at dinner, and we were talking about Earth Day, and we were recalling when we were college students, and we were actually participants in the very first Earth Day at the two universities that we attended at that time. Our universities had what was called a teach-in on that day, which meant we suspended classes and went to activities such as those that you're going to be engaged in today. And we have very fond memories of that day and of the participation in, at that time. At that time, the focus was actually on more on population growth, zero population growth. And then, the participation has and involvement has changed to things such as recycling, and now green energy and sustainability are foci for Earth Day. So we go with the issues of the day, and I'm very happy to be a participant in today's activities. Our speaker today is a vocal, active, creative advocate for sustainability. She has demonstrated how business can play a role in sustainability and in improving our environment. Dr. Sonia Neuenhaus is president of the Madison Environmental Group, and she is also the president of Community Car. Madison Environmental Group is a creative consulting firm that works with individuals and organizations to improve communities and the environment. Community Car is Wisconsin's first car share organization. She founded that organization in 2003. Recently, Dr. Neuenhaus authored an act, Steps to Greener Living, and that also is part of her involvement in Madison Environmental Group and in her history in Community Car as well. She also founded Waste Cap Wisconsin, a nonprofit organization that provides recycling assistance to businesses. She's worked as an environmental analyst at Wisconsin Power and Light, where she developed award-winning environmental programs. Dr. Neuenhaus received her PhD from the University of Wisconsin-Madison and her BA from Michigan State University. She's received a number of awards as well, and I'd like to recognize those. She's received the Wisconsin Partnership for Clean Air Act Award, or I'm sorry, for Clean Air Award in 2003, a Dane County Small Business Award in 2004, and in 2006 she was awarded the Most Meaningful Place to Work in Madison. Dr. Neuenhaus is on the board of Thrive, the Madison Community Foundation, and Sustain Dane. She's also chair of the Mayor's Solid Waste Advisory Committee. She lives part of the year, at least, in Viroqua, Wisconsin. So to kick off University of Wisconsin-Whitewater's own teach-in day for 2009, for those of us who recall the earlier ones, and for those of you who are new to this activity, Dr. Sonia Neuenhaus. Sonia.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me. It's truly an honor to be here, and hope I can come back at another Earth Day event. I'm already seeing it's off to a good start. So I was my talk today is really about my career as an eco-entrepreneur. And afterwards, I please welcome any question, even if it seems inappropriate, ask it. I might not answer, but I'm really here to help you and hopefully share with you an example of an environmental business person. So I'll start with a little history, and then I'll go into my career path quite in detail, and I'll end with some tips to create your career. So bear with me, faculty, since you're already in your career path. So as you'll see in this talk, there's themes going, and I won't say what they are right now, but you'll understand at the end. So early on in my childhood, I loved building things, and this is my cousin and I in Finland. I'm a first-generation American. My mother's from Finland, my father's from the Netherlands, and they came over here when they were about 30 years old. So that's a little raft that I built, and it worked. We went all the way across the lake, and this is a fort that I built with my cousin. The first vehicle I drove was this tractor, and the first green roof that I helped build was this green roof in our woods on a yurt. My parents bought a farm on the day I was born. My father was a businessman, and he bought this farm sight unseen, yes, and we spent every weekend here fixing it up. The first business I had was selling tomatoes at a farmer's market, about 11 years old. The second business I had, these weren't incorporated, I did not pay taxes. The second business I had was in high school, a carpool service. So the high school I went to was quite a ways away, and I drove three different people to school every day, and they paid me $3 a week, and that covered the cost of the car. So when I was 17, my father took me out on my birthday and said, "Sonia, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up?" I had no idea. So instead, we decided to talk about what I liked doing. Welcome. Are you all high school students or Whitewater students coming in? Great. Nice to meet you. So we're at the time when I'm 17. So on my birthday, he took me out to lunch. We talked about what were my interests. I told him, and he knew this very well, that I liked to travel and I liked socializing and entertaining. So he thought that maybe I would be interested in hotel restaurant management. It never occurred to me in high school to think about going to hotel restaurant management school. But when he said that, it just resonated with me, and I thought, what fun. I could be in the business world and be socializing and helping other people have a good time. So I went to Michigan State because they're very well known for their hotel restaurant program, and it was their hotel restaurant program was in the business school, so I sort of had a dual major, and that was very beneficial to me. I worked for the president of the university as one of his three catering supervisors, and it was a wonderful job throughout my tenure there. I also needed to live very cheaply, as I paid for all my room and board and books, etc. And so I lived in this cooperative house called Monty House. It was a little bit like Animal House, but it was the cheapest place to live on campus that also served food. Here, we all volunteered our time to run this co-op, and I was the president of the co-op, which meant I was the landlord, so I was doing things like helping really guide the organization, figuring out what our remodeling projects would be, making sure people paid rent, etc. Well, in my junior year, I was inducted to Mortar Board. I don't know if you have this honor society here on campus. It's a grades and service type of honor society. And in this extracurricular activity that I did, we were asked by a professor on campus, who probably got an Earth Day award, if we would lobby the president of the university to institute a recycling policy. Because this was, now we're in 1988, and the 1990 Earth Day was coming up in 2 years, and he really wanted a policy in place in 2 years. So what I did was committed myself to getting 1,000 signatures on a petition to send to the president of the university, who I worked for, by the way, in his house as a catering supervisor, that we should recycle on campus. Well, I hit the sororities and fraternities because that was an easy way to get 45 signatures all at once, and I met my 1,000-person goal, and interestingly enough, in convincing 1,000 people, I convinced myself that I wanted to go into a different path for my career. So at the young age of 21 or 22, I changed my career path and decided I wanted to go into environmental studies instead of hotel restaurant management. So I came home that spring break, my junior year, and I said to my parents, "You know, I don't think I want to be in hotel restaurant management anymore, but don't worry, I'll finish my degree. I really want to study garbage and recycling." And they looked at me, "Sonia, I don't see you in science, you know, I see you as a social person." I said, "Well, maybe what I'll do is I'll study recycling in the hotel restaurant management field." They were very supportive. They looked at me a little strangely, but then they helped me find a program that was very good in the environmental field, and selfishly, it was in Wisconsin. Maybe that was their ploy, but University of Wisconsin in Madison has a fantastic program for environmental studies. It's called the Nelson Institute for graduate school. So my tools of my trade became boots, garbage bags, and a mess. In undergrad, I took a real estate class, and that professor talked to us about buying real estate as soon as you possibly can. So the savings that I had accrued from when I was about 11 years old amassed to $10,000, and I bought this house, this little house for $30,000 in Madison, that was so horrible looking that my father told my sister that it's a bulldozer and that he would never stay overnight in it. But my stepmom was very supportive, and she said, "Sonia, just paint everything white. It'll be cute." So that's what I did, and 10 years later, I sold the house for $100,000. So as going to graduate school, I needed to pay for school, and so I needed a job. And I saw an internship announcement my first year in graduate school. It was Wisconsin Power and Light, a local utility company, looking for an environmental intern that had soil science background or law background. Well, I had no environmental background, but I did take one law class in business school in undergrad. So I applied for the job, but it was so obvious that I wasn't qualified. But how do you get experience if you don't have it, right? So I was quite confident in the interview because, again, it was so clear that I wasn't qualified, that I was relaxed. And then my future boss said to me, "Well, Sonia, what would you like to do in 5 years?" And I said, "Joe, I would like to have my own company helping businesses reduce waste and recycle." So the next day he called and he said, "Well, we hired someone for the job you applied for." Sigh. "But we'd like to hire you to start a recycling program for Wisconsin Power and Light." Great. So that standard question, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up, really helped me in that instance. So I ended up turning my internship into a 4.5-year career because I convinced them after my internship how much money they could save by keeping me on. And the program, the Just Redo It recycling program, won awards, and then I also started a program called Stewards of Nature, which is a volunteer employee program to get people out to, you know, plant trees, et cetera, and help with the Nature Conservancy. So in the meantime, that little house that I bought when I was 24, I was outgrowing it a little bit. It was a 650 square foot home. I lived in the living room, I rented out the bedroom, and then we had a dining room that I made into a dining living room. But it would have been nice to have a living room. So I found a loan at the city of Madison and built on this addition and made the house now a whopping 800 square feet. And actually right now, this same house is for sale for $160,000. It's sort of fun. I visited it last weekend, and they haven't changed anything. They even kept the curtains that I had 10 years ago. So I'm at my internship at Wisconsin Power and Light. Excuse me. And I'm about to do my PhD research, which meant I had to move to Madeline Island. Osai, beautiful island, to study garbage. I picked an island because you could study everything. Your sample size of N was pure because I could interview everybody, see everything, because it was so small. So I went to my boss and I said, "I'm very sorry, I love my job, but I need to quit to move to Madeline Island to do my research." He looked at me and he said, "Sonia, what would you really like to do?" It never occurred to me that he would ask me this. So I made something up on the spot. I said, "Well, I'd really like to consult back to you on the programs that I'm working on, but I need to work from Madeline Island, and I can only work 25% time." Deal. So that's how I became a consultant. That project then ended through the end of the year, my consulting gig, and I had a year of fellowship to do my research. So this is me also. I didn't own a car. I borrowed my friend's car to go up to Madeline Island. But in the winter, you drive on the ice. Has anyone done that before here? You get to the island by driving on ice. So I just had to put that picture in there. I lived in very small houses, which I loved. And you'll understand why later. So my research for my PhD was not just looking at garbage, but it was looking at the methods that we study environmental issues. So my garbage was sort of like my mouse in my experiment. I did an interdisciplinary research approach of examining, listening, and observing. So I combined qualitative with quantitative measures. The traditional way to look at garbage and recycling is doing a waste characterization study where you sort all of the garbage into 22 categories in statistically significant weeks of the year. I hired my friend Renee to help me. She didn't want to go through the restaurant garbage because it had maggots, but you can imagine we went through everything. Imagine what you throw out and every little piece we put in 22 categories and weighed them. I did 75 in-depth interviews asking people about garbage, and then I spent 99 hours of field observation walking around and looking at garbage, literally opening up garbage cans and then sort of looking at what I call pre-garbage, doing participatory research at the motels and restaurants. So like these styrofoam cups would be pre-garbage. So my fellowship ended. It was a year-long research study, and I needed employment again to pay for the rest of my grad school. So I saw on email was pretty new at these days, I saw a job posting for the DNR, the Department of Natural Resources. They were looking for someone to start a nonprofit organization. It was a two-year contract, but the job was full-time. I couldn't work full-time because I was in school full-time. So I hemmed and hawed, but the job was perfect because you remember how I said that I wanted to help businesses reduce waste and recycle? Well, that's what this nonprofit was all about. So I submitted a proposal for 50% time the first year and 80% time year two, and I was awarded the contract. So it was a wonderful experience. After the 2 years, though the DNR, I think, anticipated that I would stay on as executive director, that was never my intention. I wanted just the two-year contract, and then I wanted to start my own business. So by now, I've graduated with my PhD, finished up my two-year contract. The woman that I hired is still running the organization 10 years later. She's doing a fantastic job, Jenna Kunde. And I started Madison Environmental Group. And here, I had the choice of either, after a graduation, getting that big job in Washington, D.C., which is what I thought I was going to do, or stay in Madison, but there wasn't the type of job that I really wanted in Madison. But my family was in Madison, my sister lives there, my parents live an hour away, and I was very rooted. And I just decided I'll start now. I'll just start my business a little sooner than I had anticipated. In business school, in my marketing class, I learned that first impressions matter. So what I did was I had, in my budget, I had allocated $350 a month for rent, but I wanted the best address to make me sort of look bigger and more important as a company. So I found a building on the Capitol Square where they were redoing their offices, and they hadn't put up the walls yet. So I went up there and I said, I have $350, but I really want to be on the square. How small can you make an office? And they did. They built out a really small office that was just 6 feet wide. And this window was my view to the Capitol. So today, our services are the following. We offer strategic sustainability planning, eco-footprint analysis, or sort of baseline research, eco-solutions, such as construction waste recycling, transportation option programs, green building services, then green communications, because if you're doing good baselines, you're putting solutions and you have good stories to tell. And then we've always had this research and development core, though it's not so obvious on our website. Here are our talented staff. And just to give you a sense, two of them have MBAs. One's a lawyer, one's a soil scientist, one's in communications, a landscape architect, et cetera. So the first contract I had, and by the way, I hired somebody day one, even though I didn't yet have a job, because I knew I wasn't so good at the detail of bookkeeping, even though I love numbers, and hired a bookkeeper administrator right away for just 10 hours a week. The first job I had that we got as a contract was for Alliance Energy, which was the sort of parent company for the company I worked for before, Wisconsin Power and Light. And it was doing integrated land use planning for manufactured gas plant sites. I didn't know what manufactured gas plant sites were, but when I got the call, they said, could you work on land use planning or something for manufactured gas plant sites? Sure. So then the next call I did was to my friends in grad school. What's an MGP site? What is this? And again, just learned about it. And it wasn't so much the topic that was important. It was the methods of how you solve the problem, and that I was confident in. So it didn't really matter that I didn't know what an MGP site was. So then after we had three big contracts on the integrated land use planning, we worked on construction waste recycling, and this was very new at this time. And this also came out of my PhD research, where I found on the island that construction waste was actually the biggest problem that they had. So for example, in Dane County, I don't know what your statistics are in this county, but in Dane County, 46% of the landfills are filled with construction and demolition waste. And this is very easy waste to deal with. It's not rocket science at all. It's quite clean. So it's sort of astounding that they're filled up with C&D waste, and yet it's so simple to recycle. So some of our sort of bread and butter in our business is helping building companies and buildings recycle. So now we used to set a 50% recycling goal, but now we've upped it to 75 as we're achieving it. And here's an example of our signage and a superintendent that we work with. Well, we're in now to about year three of Madison Environmental Group, and we continue to read. We had a staff of three. Excuse me. And just like you're in school and you're learning, or just like you're a professor, you keep reading. We read this book by Union of Concerned Scientists, of which we were members. And this book really changed our lives, because it said that transportation is the single most important behavior that you should change in order to help the environment. They poo-pooed recycling, which I disagree with. You should be a critical thinker. I think recycling is key, because it helps you change behavior, because all of you know how to recycle, and it's easy. It's routine, but it's not yet routine to drive less. It's not yet routine to turn off every light in your house when you're not in the room. So this book said driving less is the most important thing. So then we needed to learn about driving and transportation, because again, that topic wasn't anything we were familiar with. So for example, in Wisconsin, these are Wisconsin stats, 29.9% of the greenhouse gas emissions in Wisconsin come from transportation, and 98% of that 29% is from you and me driving. It's not from Amtrak or the bus or airplanes, it's us. And for every mile you drive, you emit 1 pound of CO2 for every single mile. Again, we didn't know anything about transportation, but we were confident in our methods and our research and development. So a friend from grad school had found me online, and we were just communicating back and forth. I asked him, oh, what have you been writing lately? He sent me an article about him and his wife and how they joined a car sharing program in Portland, Oregon. Within 20 minutes, I knew that's what was needed for Madison, and that was more of a business approach that I thought would be really fun to work on in the transportation sector. So we received a small grant from the DOT, the Department of Transportation, and conducted a feasibility study to see if car sharing would work in Madison, Wisconsin. So again, we used the similar tools that I used that I learned in school, survey research and focus groups. And I did field observation. I read a book, and I decided after halfway through this book to conduct a 6-week trial separation of my car, that is. I parked my car and just pretended I didn't own it, and discovered that, in fact, the bus went to my sister's house. It never occurred to me to take the bus to my sister. It occurred to me in the winter to take the bus to school and work, but never for, you know, visiting friends or errands. And then when I figured out that renting a car from Enterprise 3 weekends a month was cheaper than owning my paid-off Honda Accord, I decided to divorce. So I sold the car that I bought from my mom after graduation, because when you graduate, you need a car, right? I didn't have a car in school, but when you graduate, I got a car, because everyone gets a car. But again, for economic reasons, it wasn't, the environmental is what motivated me, but it was the economic decision that turned the corner and motivated me to sell the car, and I hopped on my bike. So 2003 was a busy year for Sonia Neuenhaus. that we were 5 years into our business, and I remember my father saying, because he was a businessman, he said, "Sonia, when your business turns five, you either decide to grow or you stay the same, but you need to make a decision." And I wanted to grow. My first dream was not to have a bigger business. We're still small. We're only 10 people at Madison Environmental Group. But my first dream was just three people, an administrator and a researcher and myself. It never occurred to me to have a bigger business. But then as we were getting projects and making more of a difference, I thought, well, if we have more employees, we can make a bigger difference. So in this year, 2003, was our growth year. We were also asked by the city of Madison to start in an environmental action program that we named Enact, and it's a Steps to Greener Living program. And we just published a book here, and I'd like to leave at least one copy for you. But it's a free program, and I'll tell you more about that later. It's sort of like an action-oriented book club where you form a team, or a class can form a team. You go through the chapters of driving less, you know, conserving water, saving energy. And you support each other, and you take actions, and you commit out loud. And then you also do survey research. So you do a pre and post survey of your behavior. And it's all about learning from neighbors and learning from each other. So this is one of my grad school friends, and she was the one that taught me about front load washing machines. And then my neighbor was the one that showed me this amazing refrigerator that's extremely efficient that I bought online after I saw hers. And as I said, it was a year of growth for Madison Environmental Group. Our lease was also up in September of that year. So in January, I knew we had to move, and I also told myself, I was 37 at this time, that by the time I'm 40 years old, I want to own my own building to both grow my own personal equity, but also to control costs for my business, because as rents go up every year, if I own the building, I could manage that. So you remember that little house that I showed you before? Well, I sold that house after about 10 years of owning it and bought this house just 14 blocks away on Rutledge Street, if you're familiar with Madison, near the co-op. And at the time, this house I bought for $180,000, and I was very nervous because it was $20,000 more than what I thought I could afford. But my PhD advisor said, "Don't worry, it's location, 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 and that's what that house is. It'll go up in value." Well, only 2 or 3 years later, that house went up to $250,000 in value. So then what I did is I pulled out the equity of that house. I had no cash, right, but I had money in my house. I pulled out the equity even before I found a building for my business, and I had, by that time, I think $50,000 in equity. I put it in T-bills, and I just let it sit there as a future down payment for a building. Well, then I set my dreams to be, again, at the perfect address on the Capitol Square. But how do you think somebody like me with no cash could afford a building on the Capitol Square, Madison? But I just decided to walk around and look, and I also walked all the way home and tried to picture what other buildings maybe I could afford. Well, I had a wonderful mentor, Gail Selk, and she said, "Sonia, buildings don't go for sale, the good deals. You need to find them before they go for sale." So to make a long story short, but if you teach a real estate class, I'd love to come back and give that story in a real estate class. I found a woman who owned a restaurant in this building, this brownstone here on the square. Odessa Piper owned a restaurant called L'Etoile, and she was looking for a business partner. She didn't call it selling her building, but I approached her, and then if you have negotiation classes, the trick to negotiation is listen, listen, listen. So I spent hours and hours listening to her and just sitting on the Capitol lawn, and what were her needs, and how could I make her an offer? So what I ended up doing was offering her a land contract sale, because I only had $50,000, and $50,000 is not enough of a down payment to buy a building on the Capitol. But after listening to her, I realized she didn't need one lump sum of cash. What she needed was a retirement plan, and she already almost had the building paid off. It turns out she only had $40,000 left on her mortgage. So my $50,000 was perfect. I offered her $50,000. She had an extra $10,000 in cash. And then every month I paid her instead of a bank. And we basically did a transaction of small business person to small business person. And then 3 years later, I was able to buy her out because the equity and the value of this building kept going up, that I had the right ratios to go to a bank. And it was just a fantastic example of how, you know, you just set your dreams and listen and work it out. So then it was July 1, and remember September 1 is when my lease was expired? Well, I hadn't yet closed on the building, and I looked at her, and I said, I need to remodel your third floor for my offices, and we're not yet closed, but if I don't start now, I can't move in. And she just handed me the keys, and with some faith, because I didn't close till July 31st, we started construction. And here is where we learned a lot about green building. So this is what our space looked like on the third floor. And 7 weeks later, we moved in a green construction. And this is our office space. We saved a lot of money using salvaged materials. And again, I won't go into all of these details, but just hope you look. But all of the light fixtures and doors, for example, are all salvaged. So then that we did move in. And then 22 days later, on World Car-Free Day, we launched our first ever car-free challenge to motivate people to drive less. In October, 1 month later, we launched Community Car. And again, you remember I had no cash, right? I could barely afford that building. Well, I had an idea of Community Car, and we did a business plan in pro forma. So I found 6 investors and 2 bank loans, and one of the banks used my building as equity as collateral, and we launched this company with 3 cars. Our motto is to own less and live more. We now have 17 cars, more than 1,000 members. We just hit our goal exactly by 3 people at our 5-year anniversary. So how does Community Car work? Well, you join online. By the way, car sharing, if you haven't heard of it, is a member-based car sharing service. So it's basically a car by the hour when you need it 24/7. And it's for people that either don't own a car or bus or bike to work, and this is their occasional car in the middle of the day, or they want to avoid the purchase of a second car. So you just join online, then you reserve the car. This is when we were young and only had 4 cars, but it's in 15-minute increments that you can reserve the car. Then you just walk to the car, and then you attach your key fob to the windshield, which unlocks the car, and the key is attached to the steering wheel, believe it or not, and then you just drive away, and you pay for the hours and miles you drive. Our rates are from $7.75 to $9.25 an hour, and everything's included, gasoline, insurance, everything. So Madison Environmental Group is also growing at this time. By the way, both companies are on the third floor in the building that I mentioned before. And one example of our services that was growing was deconstruction, recycling, and reuse. I don't know if here on campus you've ever had to take a building down in order to put up a new building, but this happens often in Madison. We noticed that there's, again, so much that really could go to waste. So all what I call depreciated assets are left in the building, fixtures, furniture, et cetera, and we find a home for it. We even put words like free on the bushes, and people take the bushes. So out of that, we keep noticing doors that are going into the landfill because there's not a very good market for commercial solid doors. And it just was very sad to see all of this good wood go to waste. So we wrote a grant, which was accepted from the DNR, the Department of Natural Resources, to do a feasibility study to start another business called Full Circle Furniture, making furniture out of doors. Well, what happened in this feasibility study, nothing always works out perfectly, is it turned out to be not so feasible to scale this business up, because the door veneer is so thin that it couldn't go through a machine very well. When we took it to a manufacturing company, one of them said, oh, sure, we can do it. And the other one said, no, that won't work, that it needs to be hand sanded. So it turns out it doesn't work. You do have to hand sand all of the doors, which makes the price of the furniture quite expensive. But I think the furniture is beautiful, so even though this business didn't take off, we have a website just to inspire people, and now we have a a kit, if you will, that you can make your own Madison table and benches, because if you want to do the sanding, why not have a beautiful set yourself? So we sell that kit for $25. At the same time, this is now about 2004, 2005, the green building services and interest is really gaining momentum, and here you're doing is the same, I hear. So this is really now our bread and butter, is being leadership in energy environmental design consultants, and this is one of our projects. So very recently, another sort of trend that we see in the green movement, and was even mentioned on the radio today of NPR, whoops, is climate change and cap and trade programs. So the climate registry of now, this is the method that we use to help customers to identify their greenhouse gas emissions, is most likely the method that will be regulated by about 2012, maybe earlier. And here's just a little bit of detail on it. But now we're providing this service for companies. So for example, for Organic Valley and American Family, and maybe for Whitewater someday, we can assess your greenhouse gas emissions in the protocol that will be an apples-to-apples protocol regulated. So here I am, and where are you? You know, you're maybe 17, 18, some of you in high school, and 22, 23, 24 in college. Well, now I'm 42, soon to be 43, and I wonder what I'll be thinking when I'm my grandmother's age here at 82. I feel like I'm midstream. I have a good 20 years left, if not longer, in my career. So I'm actually doing what you're doing, thinking about my future. So to help me, I did a program called Environmental Leadership Program, which is a national fellowship, and its aim is to diversify the environmental movement and to create more leaders in the environmental movement. This was a tremendous help. There were four retreats that we went on about diversity and sort of planning your future. And what I tried to do is think, well, how do you go backwards to go forwards? I think it's good to look at, what did you love doing? Who are you? What were you passionate about when you were 10 years old? Well, I found this picture of me at a science fair, and it's the basic principles of solar energy. You know, when I was little, I wanted to build little houses off the grid on my parents' farm. You know, then I wanted to be a carpenter. Then I wanted to be an architect, but was steered away because of the science and engineering at that time wasn't for girls. But I want to do it. I want to go back to what I wanted to be when I grew up. So I decided I'm starting another company called Casa Kit Homes. This has been 2 years in the development, and the company probably won't start for another 2 years. But we'll be selling small, smart, sustainable homes. And the vision for this company is to provide green living solutions for eco-pioneers who want to live simply and lightly on the earth. The business inspiration comes from the Sears Roebuck Kit home business. Do any of you, have you lived in one? Oh, I'd love to talk with you. And so what Sears did was so brilliant. At the turn of the last century, they packaged all of their services. They sold tools, they sold furniture, they sold appliances, and they created a way to package and bundle and then sell kit homes. They sold over 100,000 homes. Here's an example of their catalog. They included the furniture, interior designs, etc. So Casa Kit Homes will include our sustainable living program and community car and our full circle furniture kits. It's a way to package our programs and provide people with a new option. We'll start with 3 single family homes and 1 2 unit, because really multifamily is much more sustainable for the environment. We'll have a 600 square foot, 720, and 1,000 square foot home. And the largest home that we'll have will always be half the size of the average new American home, which is 2,400 square feet. Because if you imagine, if you live in a smaller space, you are naturally conserving many more resources. Our green features are that there'll be passive and active solar systems, extremely energy efficient, twice as energy efficient as the greatest Energy Star home. Improved indoor air quality designed for deconstruction, because we do deconstruction services, so there won't be a lot of glues and things, so it'll be easy to take apart and recycle the materials. So now on to the tips. How are we doing on time? Good. Okay, this is the ending here, and then I'll take questions. So my tips and advice for you is to save money and live frugally. Frugally is fun because frugal gives you financial freedom to do what the hell you want. You are not bound with the golden handcuffs with a job if you save money. You can then take 6 months off to find your dream job or to start what you really want to do. So I bought this house when I was 24 by the advice of a professor that I have that I'm so grateful for. And if you say to yourself, well, Sonia, you know, that was a long time ago. You can't find a house for $30,000 anymore. Then this is my answer to you. If you were to buy a new car, let's say you move to a city after you graduate, Chicago or Madison or Boston, and you think, well, when you graduate, you buy a car because that's just what you do. Well, if you go to a bigger city that has a lot of transportation services, you don't need a car. You can join now car sharing because they're in most big cities. You will save $6,000 a year on car payments. So if you spend $1,000 a year on transportation, you have $5,000 left. In 3 years, you'll have a 10% down payment for a $150,000 condo. So you can own a house in 3 years after you graduate. It's not that hard. Second tip is finding mentors. I've been so lucky to have so many mentors, and some people are my mentors today and they don't even know they're my mentors, but I just watch them and learn from them. So this is Gail Selk on the left, my real estate mentor. These are my parents, Linda and Hank, and my PhD advisor, Joan. And then these are my bosses at Alliant Energy on the bottom. I've done a lot of volunteer work, and thank you to those who won awards. You volunteered so much, and you deserve the award you got today. In high school, I volunteered. In college, I volunteered. And then later, I ended up volunteering more for political candidates. I think you should always volunteer for what you really want to do. Don't just do it for a resume. Really do volunteer for something that you're passionate about. I was passionate about politics and thought I would go into politics someday, but then after I volunteered so much, I realized this is not for me. I don't want to shake hands for 4 hours just to raise some money. But in the meantime, I helped other people raise money, and it ironically, it paid off because they're very kind to me and help and support our programs, which I didn't anticipate because I was volunteering for the cause. And then, create community. Your businesses, your work life might not work out how you planned, but your friends will always be there with you. But it takes time to make friends. I started a knitting group about 20 years ago. You know, these are quilts, they're not, but we also make quilts when everybody has a baby. But we meet every Wednesday. Now we meet just about once a month. But that consistent routine friendship over the years has been tremendous, and these are the girlfriends that I go back to when I have problems. And then exercise. And by the way, I'm saying this tips advice to tell myself out loud that I need to exercise more too. But really, if you stay healthy, you'll be less depressed. If you have a regular routine in your life, they say walking and exercise really helps motivate you. So in these tougher economic times, stay in shape for your health, your mind. But also, if you're going to be in business for yourself, healthcare is expensive. So the healthier you are, the cheaper your healthcare will be and will give you more options. So I played pond hockey for about 10 years, but my boyfriend lives in Viroqua, Wisconsin, where I live half time. And so unfortunately, I'm not on this team anymore. So seek inspiration. You know, if you can't afford to go to a conference, go just do your own little conference and go on a tour. And this, I try to visit places that inspire me. And this is one of the places that really inspires me, the Urban Ecology Center in Milwaukee. I hope you visit it if you haven't. So you can also visit our offices. We'd love to see you. Don't just wait for the second Friday of the even months. But we have an open house peanut butter and jelly lunch just for the community. And we hope that you visit. And then I'll just leave this up. You can take the information, and now I'll take questions. And really, any question goes. Thank you.
Thank
Do any of you want to start your own business, not just work in business? Oh, great. Excellent. Were there any sort of themes that you saw? Yes, do you have a question? Fantastic. Oh, that's so exciting. That's fantastic. So for those of you that didn't hear that, she said that they demolished some buildings on campus and use WasteCap, the nonprofit I started a while ago, to manage all of that recycling efforts. Good. Yes. Mm-hmm. Sure. So diversifying is good. Luckily, I have two businesses. Community Car is going very strong and growing because in a hard time, people look at their transportation costs, and transportation is the second most expensive item on your household budget after your rent or your mortgage. And in some cases, it's even higher than your rent or your mortgage. So people are really evaluating how many cars they own and getting rid of a car and joining us. Or they're evaluating parking, and they don't want to spend the $8 a day to park, and so they're busing into campus or busing to work and then using our service in the day as their emergency car. Madison Environmental Group, knock on wood, is still strong, even though our business is mostly in the building industry, or it's sort of boutique consulting, like doing greenhouse gas assessments, et cetera. But I'm a little nervous and just glad that we have two businesses and the real estate. So I basically have three things going on to secure our future. But business is always up and down. So if you go into business, you should expect up and downs. And you just smile, work hard, and just go through it. So. But that also is why, you know, living frugally is important. And when I say frugal, maybe that's a word that, maybe I should think of another word. Maybe it's just living smart. But, you know, recently I got addicted to chai. Oh, unfortunately, it's $3.50 a pop for a really good chai. So on vacation, I took a long vacation over Easter, you know, four-day weekend, and I learned how to make chai. And actually, it's better than most of all the chais I've had, except for Le Chual's chai. You know, so I'm saving at least, you know, $12 a week now, bringing my homemade chai to work. Yes. I think alternative modes of transportation are key. Not just high-speed rail is one of them, but high-speed rail won't work for many people unless you live, you know, right on those corridors. But I think it's where we need to go, where we have to go. Also, for these communities to act more as a region, Minneapolis, Madison, Milwaukee, and Chicago need to work together and be more of a community rather than, oh, those people in Illinois, or, oh, Minnesota's better, I wish we were like them, but we're not, you know. We really need to work together. And I think in the future, my vision for, you know, 50 years from now is that we'll have regional governors, because resources will get so scarce and be more precious. And for example, in Wisconsin area, in this whole region, we have amazing water resources. We have amazing agricultural resources. Well, other states will want our resources. So we'll need to sort of unite and contribute, you know, not just be, this is mine. But I think we'll in the future, maybe have regional governors in the United States. Yes. Sure. We have 17 cars. We have maybe 7 to 10 hybrids. We have a Mini Cooper convertible, a Toyota Sienna van, a pickup truck. So the idea is we have a variety. And our peak times are between 10 a.m. and 5 p.m., so middle of the day use, and then Saturday mornings. But most people can reserve a car within the same day. But if you reserve it the same day, you might not get your first choice car. But because the cars are spread out all throughout Madison, you can just, you know, hop on your bike and go to the next car. Yes? Sure. The question is, is there a system for the elderly for a community car, people that maybe can't drive, like a rideshare? That was actually one of the business ideas, marketing ideas I had when we started. Unfortunately, for insurance reasons, other people can't drive people around. But organizations can, and one of our cars is parked at a senior center, and the staff there is allowed to drive people around. But that's a really good point, that as our society ages and all the baby boomers age, we need a variety of ways to help people feel independent. Yes? Mm-hmm. My intention for the Casa Kit Home, she asked if is your intention to have you sort of shipped in a bundle like what Sears Roebuck did, and the answer is yes. There's a good book on the history of prefab. A professor in London wrote it, and it says basically that prefab doesn't make money. You know, so all of these really cool Dwell prefab homes you're seeing, they're probably not turning a profit because you need to sell a lot of homes to support the manufacturing of prefab. I do think in Wisconsin, my guess is WIC and a few of the Wisconsin modular homes are financially successful, but I'm copying the Sears model, which is also less of an investment as a business person, and that's basically they were marketing and distribution of all of the goods. So we will basically package the lumber, the windows, the whole house in a box, and then you build it, but mostly your contractor will build it. But it'll be cheaper because it's all the guessing work is taken out, and they'll be less wasteful because everything will be cut to size and exactly measured. Oh, yes. So the question was, will the kit homes be equipped with solar panels? All of the homes will be solar. You'll have two options, either solar ready or with the panels, but none of them will come without even being solar ready. So, and also none of them will come with low VOC paint. They'll all have no VOCs in them. So we'll have standards and thresholds that we will adhere to, but then have like more affordable options within it. And actually, I take back a little bit. They won't be shipped anywhere in the U.S. We're starting just in a regional approach so that the items are all regional, so that the windows will be from the Midwest, the wood from the Midwest, et cetera. Yes. Our commitment is that all of the cars that are average fleet gas mileage per hour is 35. So that means to get that average, we have, I don't even remember exactly, between 7 and 10 hybrids, and then the other cars, but none of them are veggie grease yet or biodiesel, but we would like that in the future. Yes. Yes and no for all of these things. So community car is already an extremely new, innovative business that was very hard to get off the ground because banks didn't know what the heck it was. You know, I even had the money, I had the cash from the investors, and I couldn't even lease cars because the leasing agents were confused. I couldn't get insurance because they're like, how can you have 1,000 people share, you know, a car? So it was very odd to have the money and not to be able to buy the services. But it did get off the ground. But, what was your question again? Oh, the plug-in. So the business is already so innovative that I'm very careful to take other risks within the business. But we will, I'm confident that we will in the future have a plug-in, but we'll wait until it's been really tested in the cold weather and see how that works. Well, it's just been a pleasure to be here, and I have the book that you can get on Amazon.com or on our website. I have a couple business cards, community car brochures, and I'm happy to meet with anybody right now. Thank you.